it was still not a mass cultural phenomenon dealing with these people. So I always tried to talk about New York to understand what it was to be born in New York in 1926. In that city, two pieces, compositions were written. One, 1926, Varese Integrals, and a song of George Gershwin, Someone to Watch Over Me, also 1926. One was written in Greenwich Village, and the other one was written in a penthouse overlooking the Hudson River. So that is the marvelous plurality of New York. As far as folk music, I think what I did mention, which is very curious, is that if Aaron Copland would use a tune like the Shaker tune in Appalachian Spring, it's not necessarily just Shaker. It's just a great tune, just a marvelous tune. But when Berg would use a tune, folk music, in the violin concerto, it's a very kitschy, sentimental, Tyrolean tune, which works beautifully in every sense, even structurally, into the violin concerto. But it's something that, as an American, I had a friend, President Kennedy died, and there were some pieces written at the time in memory of President Kennedy. And in this piece, he quotes, "Dee, da, 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 hail to the chief." Now, when I saw on the television of the Washington, D.C., of the funeral cortege, just a few horses, and the casket of Kennedy, and you heard the Marine band play that tune, slowly going down the avenue there, it was very, very moving. Fabulously moving. The right tune, the right kind of death, the right kind of cortege. Fabulous. But when my friend used it as an arrangement, as a memory of Kennedy, hail to the chief, and tried to, it didn't work. There are always these problems. I remember as a young man reading something by Chekhov. There was pestilence throughout the Crimea. And he wrote, he was also a journalist, and he went to write an article about the death and the thousands and thousands of people dying of typhus in the Crimea. And as he was reading his dispatch, his article for the newspaper on the train, he tore it up because he felt that there was something basically insincere with the way he read, being that he was a sophisticated Moscow writing about people dying of typhus. That after he left it, it was not real to even describe it. And the problem with folk music is that psychologically, it might be a, how can I explain, bogus, artificial identification. Like I would tell a European student, just because you speak German doesn't mean you understand Beethoven. You know, they think they speak German, they're German coach. Or French, you know, if I speak French, he thinks Jacques, he's Francoise Vallon. Because of the lilt of the language. And I think that's one of the problems of folk music. I never liked white performers playing black jazz. I always felt that we have a term, slumming. I don't know if slumming. You're going like, you're going into another culture and you're making believe that it's part of your culture.
You're sort of stealing the image?
But more than stealing, you're identifying with that which even the people that do it have problems with. You know.
Well, if I may switch my background.
Yes.
Say I
excuse me, would you consider folk music as an aspect of influence?
Yes, if you went, yes, that would be. I mean, if you imagine that folk music in the European countries today is more or less exotic thing. You have to go to special places to hear it at all. So any sort of influence would be also from folk music. Why? I mean, any sort of closing yourself to an influence because you are afraid that it might damage your development, and consider illusion, a way of blocking yourself from possible growth. Anyway, I should just finish the sketch of this line, because from one extreme to the other, around 63 young composers among me, there was among them I was, and Nørholm and Peter Gudmundsen Holmgren, we were the same age, born in the same year, and we seriously felt that the influence from outside had to be studied thoroughly. So we made seminars and gathered a few people around studying what was going on with the relationships and so on. And we came to make quite another way of composing with experimental attitude, and created a sort of scandal in the Danish music life, where we had become a little established already at that time, but now we are considered as traitors for several years. Were quite charlatans and any way of dirty expressions towards musicians and so on. Of course, now quite another way of coming through and be open to anything which occupied your mind now had to be replaced in any sort of tradition which had until then been unbroken in Denmark. As you know, medicine's music and the tradition of medicine, which may be called a sort of Danish folk music, Danish folk law, because it is the big father figure, you know, from all generations since medicine. And we reacted against that, and that created a sort of scandal which lasted several years. And from then on, I think the climate of in Danish music was very changed, because it was very it had a new feeling of collegiality, which was based on not that each was sitting in his own circle, writing his own naughty music, but we were investing our energies in new new ways of feeling, new ways of creating music, new ways of notation and so on. And this openness and collegiality between the 3, 4, 5 composers was our generation has kept since. I think if you go to Denmark today, you'll be quite struck by a very big openness among the younger composers from my generation to 20 years of today, which is a quite special feature. I remarked foreign composers or musicologists and journalists who have been quite struck by this feature in Danish music, that we discuss each other's music quite openly. We are not sitting in each our own tower and then keeping aloof. And this way of having an environment of a mental character, I think this has become the new background and replacing what you could call the tradition of the Nordic, the sound or whatever, Carl Nielsen, Sibelius, Franz, Grieg, and so on. So acting, interesting in the place where you are. Not to imitate the influences from your background, from your environment, perhaps even to polarize you against it. Do you know what I mean? I had, for instance, after talking to you, the idea that why maybe you have in this New York atmosphere of the hodgepodge of influences and of all these nationalities and so on, maybe you're, if I may say, aristocratic, very refined way of composing, very deep, very defined, choose each term. It might be your way of being influenced by polarizing yourself against it.
Well, I think that's, you know, we can't write music as if Freud never existed. Most of us try to. I think when New York, first of all, I don't want to make a speech about this, but I feel that essentially there are not many alternatives. Either one is conceptual about something. And if you're conceptual, then you're living in a very critical environment. Someone will say, no, not that way, this way. Or, I was just out in Los Angeles for a year. In Los Angeles, this whole thing of do your own thing, what they really mean is that it's an uncritical, perceptual. Oh, look at the light. I think I'll paint the light. No painter ever painted the light. They might have used the light as a structure. You know, either this way, or they invented, fabricated. But here I am, I'm in Los Angeles, and look at this light, and what we have in Los Angeles is the light, and now I will use my perceptions to paint this picture about what the Los Angeles air is all about. Of course, none of the painters in Los Angeles could do it. The only one that did it was Hockney. He was an Englishman. He came out there, and he's the only one that could paint Los Angeles. By growing up in New York, I grew up in a very conceptual environment. Because if you don't have folklore, then you have conceptions, technical conceptions. And I like conceptions because conceptions make you selective. I was in a jungle. I was in a conceptual jungle. When someone says you cannot do it this way, I had to really figure it out how to survive. What you're really bringing up is essentially something that nobody talks today. That is, what absolutely is the subject? Not the object. I mean, if Boulez has his music and it's a magnificent object, what is the subject of this object? And I feel that the subject in most music is the talent of the painter or the composer that does it. That Stravinsky's subject was his talent. His object was the references. What happens is that it's much more easy to recognize the source material of Stravinsky as having both object and subject. It's very easy to even recognize it in Schoenberg because of the expressionism, you see, which is a form of folk. You see. It's a little more difficult in Boulez, because the subject of Boulez is not only himself, but his intellectuality of taking the sauerkraut out of German music. You know, like Satie said he wanted to take the sauerkraut out of German music. And Boulez took the sauerkraut out of Weber. Isn't he without sauerkraut? And which is very French. I don't think he could escape People listen to my music and they say it sounds like New York. I don't know what they're talking about. They mean big time. That's what they mean when it sounds like New York. The cheap, the authority, this. But folk music, I cannot talk against it because I never had it.
No, well, I think the important thing is what you talk about, what you call object, subject, object, the diversion there. When you mentioned Stravinsky, when you look at his Russian period, that was the start period, the Linus, it's impossible to imagine that without law. But what happened after his immigration would be, in my mind, that he took up all the European music as his folklore, as his mother ground.
But I feel that the folklore, especially in Lenos and a lot of Stravinsky, like his three pieces for string quartet, the folklore is how he abstracts it and turns it into, he recycles it into an ostinato. You know, he presents it to you very, very abstractly, very, and I also feel that he uses it in order to articulate working in different keys, a polytonality, which is much more, you're able to articulate it with a tune than if you work in a whole chromatic world. People don't say, what's polytonality? So I think that he used it for technical gain. Just like I feel that I don't think that Ives had the intellectuality to realize a lot of things. Not completely, but this is another subject. Where Ives uses it as layering. Both were using it as collage, especially.
Yeah, well, also please.
You see, that's why if I have a student and they start collaging the same kind of material, I say, well, nobody knows it's collage. You know, because it's not defined, A against B against C against D. And then you know, when you're handling a tune, let's not say folk music, let's just say a tune, a shape, a motivic shape. Then you see in time, technically in other ways, in the sense where you stop. You see how much it means.
No, that I didn't get. How do you mean you see in time how it stops?
When you're working with tunes, it's very easier. It's easier to hear the differentiation when you start layering. The complement, the harmony, the counterpoint, the orchestration. It has a sense of when to stop. It has technical information, how to do it and when to stop it.
When it's layered?
Yes.
So the perception easier of seeing the different layers?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So that's in a sense what we're really talking about. So I don't even think I don't even know to what degree. I think with perhaps talking about a melodic heritage, I think that the term folk music might be, I don't know if this word is the only word, alibi. An alibi.
Yeah, or a sweat. I mean, if we look at the Eastern countries, it has been sort of a nightmare that this obsession from the government that you have to use the national trends.
Well, there's a Canadian, if she wants a commission, she'll find it easier to use Eskimo tools.
At the table aspect about it, what I find would be perhaps enlightening is that we had a discussion about what is the possibilities for composers today? I mean, the mode, which in both cases might be called the mob, I think. But you mentioned this morning the difficulty of fellow composer today, a young composer, to find a way. You said it was easier when you had Stravinsky, Schoenberg, Joyce, for instance. And young composers in Denmark today say, well, it's easier when you had this reacting in 60 against the tradition. Today, as you say, everything is allowed. You can do whatever. And this...
But wouldn't you agree?
Well, yeah, I'll finish the sentence. Okay. About what is necessary, I think, is that you have a wall to play against, to play for all things. So that you
have, I understand. You know, more than to play against the wall, to know you're playing ball, than it's a ball game.
That you all are playing.
You know, years ago, in the beginning of baseball, the men, they would use a mitt. They liked to catch it in an old with their bare hands. That was the day when they really played baseball, you know, without the mitt. That's folklore. But wouldn't you might agree that what was fantastic lesson between Stravinsky and Schoenberg was not what they brought to us, but the appropriateness of what they did in relation to what they used. That's what I learned. That I would listen to Stravinsky and everything was unbelievably appropriate. That's what I meant by selection. That both Schoenberg and Stravinsky sharpened us for survival in terms of the appropriateness of everything. So it wasn't necessarily, I would say, yes, I imitate, I'm a Stravinsky imitator. Why am I Stravinsky imitated? Because he showed me the appropriateness. Not only do they show you what to do, is they show you what not to do. I would say that to some degree, a lot of my recent music is a combination of both Stravinsky and Schoenberg. Schoenberg taught me variation. Stravinsky taught me repetition. And you put it both together and you have developmental variation.
Well, I would say that for my case, Stravinsky taught me emancipation, kind of one word. That is, if you look at the Stravinsky scores, there's a main theme and accompaniment. And that's well known from classical scores, from but with Stravinsky, the accompaniment, they're crazy. I mean, it's very crazy lines going on in the bassoons. They're making as if they are accompanying the trumpet. But if you look closely upon the lines, then they're very, they're as if they are really not appropriate for accompaniment. They have their own tics. They have their own ways of doing things which
Guess what? You didn't have to be. You could also be Jewish, like Chagall. Fiddler on the Roof. I mean, I don't know if Fiddler is on the roof. What Chagall did and what Stravinsky did were very similar in relation to Parisian sophistication.
Well, Chagall kept perhaps the background from Vitebsky long before that, so he kept his St. Petersburg.
Yes, but they all used it as technical devices. I mean, Stravinsky was the first pop art. It's like pop art. I mean, it's really collage. It's really the cubist element of putting a Russian folk tune on a new kind of background. It's still non-developmental. He doesn't use it as an organic with a whole piece is made with the segmentation. It's another kind of cubism. Very sophisticated division. I always sing it for my students. When I isolate it, say that melody, I make it purposely sound like the music of a madman because of the subdivision of E da 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 bum ba bum bum ba da 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 E da da. What? That's crazy. See, if you really think about it, it's kind of crazy. Crazier than anything anybody could write today.
Fourth and the fifth, they think they're inventing something all the time. It's
to them. Oh, and I had this nightmare where everything was unrelated to me, that there was no discovery whatsoever. No matter what I would do, anything, there was no. We all have those very wonderful moments of truth, where everything is a found object. And I had this idea, the piece opens up. I'm not going to describe the piece, but what I'm going to describe is that I use a motif.
Yes, you use a motif.
I use a motif. What is it again? I used it in another key where it's spelled out page, because I wanted to write an autobiographical thing about Dustin. And I never went this way. In all my life, I read, you know, Berg or Schumann or Clara Schumann the way we or Bach. So I decided I was going to try it too. So I had CGA, whatever it was, it's spelled out cage. CGA. Whatever it is. So I was stuck with this. You know, you get an idea. This, I never went into this world before. And it was pretty. I liked it. Because most of the time, the fourth and the fifth, they go down. I like the way you want to be. But I use it in a very kind of oscillating, nightmare way. And it comes back throughout the piece. The piece is 4 hours. I never counted how many times it came back. Maybe 40 times. But each time different. There's no development down to develop this. And I have a brilliant Hungarian student. And he came to the concert. Mr. Feldman, how could you do this? This motif for that. So I looked at him and said, because you wouldn't. It's really conceptual. But every time I used it, it was done in a new way and an appropriate way. Certainly not going to write, da-da-da-da. What am I going to do with it? There's nothing to do. Put it in different keys occasionally. Orchestrate it differently. Time it differently. That's all you can do. So maybe my folk music is the history of music and how to do things appropriately.
Well, today, I suppose the situation, as you mentioned this morning, regarding sublimation as a key word, that if we look
yes,
at
that was a subject, you know, that became a subject.
Yes. I think,
and I didn't overeat. I had a very light lunch as penance for talking about the lack of sublimation. Young composers, I decided I had to have a light lunch.
I
saw these two eating, and they had their lunch.
I think there might be a sort of further indication of that enlightenment on that. Word sublimation, as you use it there, if you refer to T.S. Eliot concerning young composers, and he's also a composer seminarist, he has written an essay on literature and tradition, in which he says states provokingly that a poet, we may say an artist, a composer, a poet not knowing the tradition will stop composing after the 30th year, stop writing poem after the 30th year, he will stop. If he does not deepen himself in tradition. And it's very provoking, but the statement is literally what you talk about sublimation, namely that if you imagine a young composer, he has his biological, you can almost say biological talent. He is able to do
reflex.
Yes, he can do something which has an impact. But at that time, if he does not reflect on himself, what am I doing?
But that's my. I'm not talking against folk music or the tradition of folk music. I cannot talk about something that I do not have.
Eliot refers not to folk tradition.
in the same article, that we take from history only what we need. So this DNA changes with everything. Some people need a lot, some people need less.
But he says also that each time a new world has been created, it changes all history. It changes all the tradition.
It changes tradition.
Yeah. That is, a young composer having made a contribution to tradition, changes the tradition, but if he does not reflect on that, what he has been doing, and that's what I think he meant with his affirmation. If you do not know what was it in fact I did there, which new thing in the universe was being created by this work, then you wish to step down in the tradition or
the problem, when you say that the problem is not to interfere with the possibilities. It's very, very hard. If I would want, I cannot say don't use folk material because it might interfere with the other aspect of the piece. You see, you might surrender to it, use it in a way as an excuse to write a piece. I mean, if I would say don't use folk material, I just had this problem. I just had this problem with a student that I took from Indiana, a woman. Her name was Margaret. She wrote this nebulous piece in a nebulous notation. And as I'm listening to this piece, I said, what you need here is a melody. She didn't know, but it was out of style to write a melody. And she didn't understand why I wanted her to write a melody. She thought, I wanted a melody. A melody, to me, at that moment in the piece, was a device to slow time. And I started to talk about how a melody slows down time. Because it defines time. In a way, a steady state is not defining time. It's like just a wash, a finger painting. And a melody defines, but the finger. She was just writing background. And there was no differentiation of time. And the only thing in this piece, stylistically, in any way, would be a nice melody. Any melody, in the right key.
But today you might consider all existing musical material on this earth as folk music. Because we are, according to McLuhan, you know, in the global beat state, where everything is possible to...
Oh, it has connotations. One of the most disturbing things is that as I got to know Scheinberg, that he used the same material, gestural material, syntax, everything, that he would use in some of his more abstract pieces for the survival of Warsaw. You see? In other words, it was still the same kind of material. It was still had an association, which a lot of people don't want to realize, that Weben and Scheinberg and Berg have an association to a certain type of romantic or expressionistic world, which is essentially Central Europe interest and concerns, just as the intervallic world. I once made this, to me this is very funny. I'm in a friend's house in London, and it's an Elizabethan songbook. And the word is, O life, O love, O death. And O death was death. And I said to my friend, I'm Jewish, I mean, that to me, I can't be so, you know, joyous, this Catholic joyous was a Catholic composer. Or the way a Protestant would handle death. Bach would always give it to you on the tritone. So even the whole word painting, ethos,
put in this way that if you look at the modernism, avant-gardism, then it is time-oriented. What did Mahler, what did Schoenberg, okay, then comes, and so on. This is time-oriented. You always purify what has been. But in the post-modernism, where space has replaced time, it sounds like a cliché saying nothing, but then I reflected, perhaps it is something quite new, because a composer being in this postmodernistic state, he might have a big chance today of saying, well, it's the important thing is not that you move from Mahler through there to X, but that is that all those different solutions, problem solving, as you call it, all those problem solvings which we have witnessed, and we have it in our book of exposition, all those problem solvings, they are there each for themselves. And there might be a very, very big task. I think that if you take and combine two of them, look at one there and from one there, and let them interfere with each other. And this does not have to be a reflective process. It can be very organic, I mean, individually rooted to have this interfering. You know what I mean? Interfering. That you, let's say, that you look at the big and crystalline way, combining this way of looking at material in the crystal-like way with a liquidy color sound. If you could concentrate on those two taken together, it would be in space then, because it's not something which time has developed, that they belong to each other. If you have, let's say, a lot of objects, and they have been developed through time, among all folklore and so on, all those are there. And if you, by intention of your intensity, you have been possessed by looking at those two aspects from two totally different periods, and bringing them together, then something very strange may happen.
You know, one of the subjects that interests me a lot, and I think for some of you last year, it's a subject that I'm obsessed with. And I think that's why we got to postmodernism. I think we got to postmodernism, as I said earlier, I feel that one of the problems is that everybody understands things in relation to style and doesn't have the technical, whatever, the background to read it as it really is and what really made it. And I think that postmodernism is really, as far as I see it, and I'm not ungenerous, is an aspect of the future of amateurism. Which leads me to a subject that interests me.
That is kitsch.
Yes, it's just finger painting, amateurs.
Well, this is one way, and I think it's what
I never thought I'd live to say it. But which makes me wonder. You see, 35 years ago, I thought that when John Cage and I were together and we were talking all the time, I thought there was a possibility of music becoming art. That's what we wanted to make it. We didn't want the status quo of music continually being about music forms. We wanted to take it out of that and the possibility that it could change and that it might be art. The possibility, not that it happened. I don't think it happened. That it could be art. There is a possibility that music is not an art form. There is a possibility. That's it on the wall. There is a possibility that music has only to do with musical forms.
That was the way he says that music does not express anything, but it is.
There is, I think he is right. The only thing is cases that you could bring into the arena new questions, for example, like what is material? For example, someone, a student of mine, is writing a piece. Instead of them looking for some hierarchical solution, I would say, try it out. Write it down. Get it down. Try it out. If you don't like it, don't use it again in the piece. No one would. I says, if you can get through 3 minutes of the piece with authority, you're lucky. Don't worry about where it goes or what. Maybe later, this is a cinematic age, we'll chop it up, we'll juxtapose it later, the way Stravinsky. Most of young composers don't know the way a lot of the music was written in the early part of the 20th century. They don't know.
In which way?
They think it's organic.
They don't know each composed in the two sections.
Responsibility. There's a traffic jam.
the material you know, because you cannot make anything new without referring to something you know. So you cannot make a variation on something which is not there. And I think.
But sometimes what we change is that which we think might be indispensable. I have some brilliant students that are very upset with my music because I have a cadence or a transition. And there's a DNA if you conduct. I have a marvelous recording of my violin concerto, which we were given for nothing, and we can't use it from Frankfurt Radio. It's destroyed by the conductor. No matter how we splice it, we can't make it better. And what was the problem? Is that every time the music changed, we made a transition, not realizing that just because the music changed in its notation meant that we're going into something, a section. So everything was treated as if he was going to crash into a car. And all I wanted was the music to just continue, and then this happens. What I was doing, in a sense, was more influence. Another thing, forget about the musical material. I think I learned more from painting than I like. And certain ways of how to solve certain problems conceptually. That composers, for example, the whole beat of transition. We were in the Metropolitan the other day, and was re-articulated by a friend of mine about the late period of Cézanne, which influenced Picasso, and why it influenced. And the whole idea of breaking the boundary between one thing to another thing, again without transition, and just having me just go into one thing and another thing. I've always found that as I always saw that in not only in late Cézanne, but an aspect of painting where they could make, where they didn't need transitions, because it was an eye thing. And what I did was substitute an ear thing. If you could do it with the eye, why can't you do it with the ear? And I would try to make that metamorphosis. Can I get from ear to ear without slowing down, without preparing? A terrific problem. And we know that in the history of music, there are many ways that they did it. This way. This is ending here and over here. This is where Schoenberg writes about it. Schoenberg did it in his late works, where the cadence of one thing was also the beginning of something else. And that kind of binding of things. There are a lot of phantoms. The phantom of information is a big phantom. Where people say there's too much information. If it's too much information, it's not good. Another criticism, there's not enough information. Nobody tells you how much information. And also a stylistic, the terror of people doing the same thing but doing it in different ways. And I always talk about the terror of the 20th century, whether you're Boulez, whether you're John Cage, whether you're Ives. They all